Good morning, brothers and sisters. Looking today at dividing carnal Christians from spiritual Christians, babes in Christ from the mature, those walking in unknown sin that is known to others, and those not living in any known sin. Interesting concept, and I think it's not something that's just intellectual. It's not something that's just emotional. It is truly a spiritual topic, and it's of very important discussion for us to really consider for ourselves. Are we carnal or are we spiritual? And I would contend with you, brothers and sisters, that to a degree, every Christian is carnal. To a degree, every follower of Jesus Christ has some kind of unknown sin, because not one of us has been made 100% absolutely perfect, as our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is perfect. So in that sense, we all have some form of carnality, worldliness, some manner of thinking and speaking and acting and imagining that goes contrary to the ways of God, the will of God, the words of God. Somehow, all of us miss the mark, fall short. But there are some things that are more obvious to those who have matured in Christ and which are not seen by those who are babes in Christ. Paul goes into this here in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, speaking to brothers and sisters who are in Christ, but who are not spiritual, but are carnal. Why? There's a very basic, fundamental thing here that Paul sees because he's spiritual, because he has outgrown where these babes in Christ are. They are very set on envying and factioning, dividing. I am of Apollos, I am of Cephas or Peter, I am of Paul. Paul's like, no, we're all of Christ. These people that you're arguing about being of, or, you know, being under, being a part of, I sit under this guy, this guy's my teacher, my master. That's what Jesus taught against. Let no one call you teacher or father, for we have one teacher, the Christ, one Father, our heavenly Father, you know, one master, one Lord. Paul is not it. Peter is not it. Apollos is not it. It's Jesus. These are just servants working in God's vineyard, in God's construction zone, if you will. Paul says, look, each one is building according to the grace of God, but it's really God doing the work through them. Brothers and sisters, we are being put together as a spiritual house. We are being put together as a farm. We're being put together as a temple that God should live in, and that God can live through to then work on others, bringing them in, and to work on those already in to help keep them in and to help us all to grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ. We are each and all both the building and the builders. We are each and all both the farm and the farmers. God, of course, is the one really doing the work through each and every one of us, so that none of us should boast. For we know that we are simply vessels for God to live in and to live through, for God to work in and to work through. This is Paul's point here in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. So let's go on. Paul says, look, you guys have envy, strife, division. Now, elsewhere, these are actually listed as things that bring spiritual death, condemnation, the lake of fire, separation from God for eternity under his wrath. But here, because the body of Christ at Corinth, the church, the ecclesia, called out of the world, the flesh, the devil, called into the Father, the Son, the Spirit, that's ecclesia, called out and called in, they're not aware yet. They don't understand this yet. It's not obvious sin like drunkenness, like sexual immorality, like idolatry. It's not obvious sin like lying, stealing, cheating, you know, whatever, fill in the blank. It's not totally obvious and understood plainly. These are things that can seem spiritual. And so Paul's like, okay, look, I get it. You guys are babes in Christ. You're new at this. You don't have an understanding yet. You're growing. If you remain in this, Paul straight up says, look, warn a divisive person, you know, once, twice, three times, kick them out of the body of Christ. A divisive person is going to spread that divisiveness so that the body of Christ becomes divided. And this is the difficulty, brothers and sisters. If there was never any division, wouldn't we all be Roman Catholics? Or perhaps Anglicans? Or perhaps Eastern Orthodox? I mean, some great general body that believes they are the one true church. But no, we have many denominations, and even non-denominational churches have differences of doctrine and practice that truly do divide. I have doctrines and I have practices that have to do with what I believe is righteousness, truth, love, and I will separate from people that do not share these common practices and doctrines, because I believe they are of the utmost importance. They are essential to the faith of Jesus Christ. One of those is actually spoken of here. I believe the scriptures are clear that we can leave our Savior. We can go away from our salvation. This is juxtaposed. This is opposite to once saved, always saved, eternal security, which I believe is a lie, a doctrine of demons, a tradition of man. I believe it's false. Paul, speaking here by the Spirit of God, talking about us being God's garden, God's farm, God's building, God's temple, says each one is building, is working. And he says, look, we have to have the foundation of Jesus Christ. I contend with you, the foundation of Jesus Christ is salvation out of all known sin. This is why Paul, speaking to the church of Corinth, in the very beginning calls them saints, calls them sanctified in Christ. We can't be called saints unless we're holy. We can't be called sanctified unless we have allowed the blood of Jesus to wash us and cleanse us from all of our known sin. If we continue living in any known sin, then Hebrews 10:28 tells us, if we go on willfully sinning, we only have the indignation of God to look forward to, the fire that destroys the adversaries. And so I believe absolutely, fundamentally, that the foundation of the faith is Jesus Christ. It is escaping out of all known sin through the power of Christ in me, the hope of glory. It is allowing the blood of Jesus to wash me, to cleanse me. It is that I be crucified with Christ so that I no longer live, but he lives in me. It is a reality for those who are actually in Christ, and Christ is actually in them. It is lived out. Then we grow in further justification, further sanctification. We grow more holy as he is holy. But there has to be this foundation of freedom from all known sin. So, Paul, using himself and Apollos as examples, speaks about the work that each and every Christian does, building on top of the foundation of Jesus Christ, sharing God's word with others, doing acts of service to others, working in the lives of others, building up the temple, building up the farm, watering, feeding, planting, sowing, reaping, harvesting, checking the building out, being an inspector, laboring. He says, look, there are different things you can use. Wood, hay, stubble, they're going to burn up at God's judgment in the day of Jesus Christ. Precious gemstones, gold, silver, those will remain. They are only enhanced by the fire of God. They're purified, cleansed. But he says, look, what if you destroy the temple of God? Now he's speaking to believers, and he says the believers are the temple of God. But what if someone destroys the temple of God? What if someone, What if someone defiles the temple? He says they will be destroyed. God will destroy them. If anyone, this includes those who are currently followers of Jesus, those who are, as of the time that Paul wrote this letter to the body of Christ at Corinth, he's saying, look, if anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy that person. So brothers and sisters, look, if you defile the temple of God, if you willfully go against the Lord, either in your own personal doctrine, personal practice, or by leading others astray, intentionally, knowingly, with false doctrine, false practice, you will be destroyed by God. You'll be cast into the lake of fire. We must let go of human wisdom, brothers and sisters. We must receive the wisdom of God. It is better to be foolish in the eyes of the world than to be wise in the eyes of God. God will grant us wisdom, as James says. He gives with liberality wisdom to all who ask. God's not holding back. He's not like playing games with us. God is sincere. God is without hypocrisy. He desires to give us his wisdom, but we have to come to him believing, as it says in Hebrews 11, believing that he is and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. And that's why Jesus taught us to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then God will give us all of the things that we need. Food, shelter, you know, etc., etc. But really we should be seeking earnestly, diligently, God himself, Jesus, his kingdom, his righteousness. That he would live in us, that he would live through us, that he would reign over us. That he would reign on the throne in our hearts as king, as lord, as master, and we would be subjects under his kingdom. This is what we need to be desiring, brothers and sisters. Keeping the foundation of Jesus Christ, building on it by growing up in the Holy Spirit into the fullness of Christ. We'll talk more about this, Lord willing, as we go into 1 Corinthians 4. Tomorrow I plan to follow up with this pre-recorded video on YouTube with a live video on Facebook. I used to do them both in one day, and it was too much, brothers and sisters. I was trying to do too much too fast, and I think it's best to stagger out what I'm doing. I'll do the pre-recorded teaching and preaching on YouTube one day, and on the next day I'll follow up with a live video on Facebook, sort of going over the same material, but in a more conversational manner, a dialogue. But here, obviously, on YouTube, pre-recorded, just straight preaching and teaching. And I appreciate you guys being here. As always, if you want to give to this ministry, you can give through PayPal, or you can mail your check to Joshua Gravis, J-O-S-H-U-A, Joshua, G-R-A-V-I-S, Gravis, at P.O. Box 5142, Woodbridge, W-O-D, B-R-I-D-G-E, Virginia, V-I-R-G-I-N-I-A, zip code 22194. May you be blessed by God in Christ. According to Acts chapter 3, verse 26, it says that God sent Jesus to bless us by turning us away from our sins. Let's be turned away from our sins. Let's be turned toward God in Christ. May you guys have a good day with Jesus, and hopefully we'll talk soon. Goodbye, everybody.